Chapter 11. And the Lord spake unto Moses and to Aaron, saying unto them, Speak unto the children of Israel, saying, These are the beasts which ye shall eat among all the beasts that are on the earth. Whatsoever parteth the hoof, and is cloven-footed, and cheweth the cud among the beasts, that shall ye eat. Nevertheless, these shall ye not eat of them that chew the cud, or of them that divide the hoof, as the camel, because he cheweth the cud, but divideth not the hoof, he is unclean unto you. And the coney, because he cheweth the cud, but divideth not the hoof, he is unclean unto you. And the hare, because he cheweth the cud, but divideth not the hoof, he is unclean unto you. And the swine, though he divide the hoof, and be cloven footed, yet he cheweth not the cud, he is unclean to you. Of their flesh shall ye not eat, and their carcass shall ye not touch, they are unclean to you. These shall ye eat of all that are in the water. Whatsoever hath fins and scales in the waters, in the seas, and in the rivers, them shall ye eat. Of all that have not fins and scales in the seas, and in the rivers, of all that move in the waters, and of any living thing which is in the waters, they shall be an abomination unto you. They shall be even an abomination unto you. Ye shall not eat of their flesh, but ye shall have their carcasses in abomination.
Based on how it all played out, it looked like he was the intended target and go for straight, because he climbed house and forced them way inside and execute him.
Central, were the bullets recovered from the bodies of Vardis and Lily Hammond so DNA coded?
Yes, Judge Magruder, it could not be otherwise.
And what was the result of the computer check of the DNA coding on those bullets?
The DNA is a perfect match for Judge Joseph Dredd.
It's a lie! The evidence has been falsified! It's impossible! I never broke the law! I am the law!
We have no case!
You gotta believe me! You have to believe me! Say it!
Your Honor, the prosecution rests.
Leviticus 19:17. Thou shalt not hate thy brother in thy heart. Thou shalt in any wise rebuke thy neighbor and not suffer sin upon him. All right? You're not supposed to let your brothers go off. All right? And that's showing him love. If you're not letting your brothers go off and you're correcting them where they stand, although a lot of our people are sensitive and they're going to take it as, you in their business, or you tell them this and that, you actually are showing them love and trying to save their life at the end of the day. All right. Now we know that the Most High heareth not sinners. So if you're indulging in sin, you're not trying to keep these law, statutes, and commandments, you're steadily going off.
Play this record you as wanna, frequently as possible.
Live your way.
And as it becomes easier for you,
play the
record
once
a day or as
and
needed.
Desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow thereby.
Shalom, Israel. This is Brother Jeremiah of AOI Las Vegas, coming at you to bring out a few precepts on sin and repentance today. It's another Wednesday milk class. Just want to touch on some basic things. Not going to go too deep, but You know, Passover is here right around the corner. We got a lot of brothers that have done great classes edifying us about how to keep the Passover. So I'm not going to go into that now. I'm just going to touch on some basic milk classes on Wednesdays from now on. So today we're going to touch on sin and repentance. All right. So Shalom to all the brethren out there, you know, out there doing the work. I'm going to jump into this class. So I'm going to start at Ezekiel 3. In verse 17. Alright. So it says, Ezekiel 3:17, Son of man, I have made thee a watchman to the house of Israel. Therefore, hear the word at my mouth and give them warning from me. So, the men of Israel, the watchmen, we're supposed to give our people warning, you know, of if they live in sin, what's going to befall them? What's going to happen to them? All right. Let me get another precept to touch on that. I'm going to jump over to Isaiah chapter 58 and verse 1. It says, cry aloud, spare not. Lift up thy voice like a trumpet, and shew my people their transgressions, and the house of Israel, Selakia, and the house of Jacob their sins. All right, let me read that one more time. Isaiah 58:1. Cry aloud, spare not, lift up thy voice like a trumpet, and shew my people their transgressions, and the house of Jacob their sins. So it says, cry aloud, lift up thy voice like a trumpet, and shew my people their transgressions. So who are the Lord's people? Canaanites? Who are the Lord's people? The Edomites? The Lord's people are the Israelites, okay? The Lord's people are the Israelites, and we're going to get a couple precepts to prove that real quick. Just real quick. 1 Kings. I'm going to jump over to 1 Kings real quick. Chapter 6. And verse 13. Okay. And it says, and I will dwell among the children of Israel, and will not forsake my people, Israel. All right? So the Lord's people are Israel. All right? I'm going to get one more precept to back that up, because like the scriptures say, precept must be upon precept. All right? Precept upon precept, line upon line, here, there, here a little, and there a little. All right? So I'm going to get one more real quick. 2 Chronicles, chapter 6, verse 6, all right? 2 Chronicles, chapter 6, verse 6. But I have chosen Jerusalem, that my name be there, and have chosen David to be over my people, Israel, okay? So that's a couple precepts proving that the Most High's people is the children of Israel. All right? We got to know that. We got to know who the Lord's people is. It's not the Canaanites. It's not the Edomites. You know? It's no other nation but that of Israel. The children of Israel. The 12 tribes. All right? So, I'm going to go back to Isaiah 58:1 real quick, so we can get all the meat off that bone really quick. Isaiah 58:1. It says, cry aloud, spare not. So we're not sparing anyone's feelings. Lift up thy voice like a trumpet. We're going to speak loud and proud about it. And shew my people. the Lord's people are the Israelites, their transgressions. What are their transgressions? What does transgression mean? Okay, let me jump over here real quick. Grab this precept. You're going to go to 1 John. 1 John chapter 3, verse 4. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law. For sin is the transgression of the law. So the transgressions is the breaking of the law. All right, let me read that one more time. 1 John chapter 3, verse 4. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law. For sin is the transgression of the law, the breaking of the Most High's law.
Why did you judge me?
You killed innocent people.
The means to an end.
You started a massacre.
I caused the revolution.
You betrayed the law.
So sin is the breaking of the law. So back here in Isaiah 58:1, when it says, show my people their transgressions, it's saying, show them their sins. Show them how they are breaking the laws, which means we have to teach them the law. All right? Brother, you shaved off your beard. That goes against the law. Sister, you're in pants. Women are not supposed to wear that which a man wear. Neither should a man put on a woman's garment. All right? So certain little things like that. All right? So let me jump over to a law that we have. I'm gonna bring out a law. Not just give no examples. I'm gonna give you one. All right. Basic law, Leviticus 19 and 17. All right. Thou shalt not hate thy brother in thy heart. All right. So we ain't supposed to hate each other. We ain't supposed to hate our brothers or our sisters in our heart, having evil thoughts of them. Thou shalt in any wise rebuke thy neighbor. All right? And not suffer sin upon him. All right? So we're supposed to correct our brothers if we see them in sin. All right? You see your brother dealing with another man's wife in the midst of adultery. You're supposed to correct that brother. All right? You see a brother going off in any way, any form or fashion. Our job is to come and correct our brothers and our sisters, all right? I'm going to start from the top. Leviticus 19, 17. Thou shalt not hate thy brother in thy heart. Thou shalt in any wise rebuke thy neighbor and not suffer sin upon him, all right? You're not supposed to let your brothers go off, all right? And that's showing him love. If you're not letting your brothers go off and you're correcting them where they stand, although a lot of our people are sensitive and they're going to take it as, you know, you and their business, are you telling them this and that? You actually are showing them love and trying to save their life at the end of the day. All right. Verse 18. Thou shalt not avenge nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. All right, we don't want to go off. All right, we don't want to be caught in the midst of sin, because we know the wages of sin is death, as it says in Romans 6:23, I believe. All right, so we supposed to love our neighbors, our people, as ourselves, and not suffer sin upon them. All right, we got to correct them when we see each other in the midst of sin and going off. All right, and we don't want to lay any sin before our people and cause them to go off, okay? Let me get this precept. Let me get this precept real quick. Romans. Romans. Let's see what we got here. Romans chapter 14, I believe. Romans 14 and 13, all right? It says, and it let us not therefore judge one another anymore, but judge this rather, that no man put a stumbling block or occasion to fall in his brother's way.
Your brothers and your sisters be born in 2 hours. One big endless supply of perfection. You know, we have a choice. We can stand here right now and create a whole race of goddamn brainwashed morons and call them judges. We can create some free-thinking people. We'll call them human. Human.
You could never control yourself. What makes you think you can control these things?
Because you're in control. You be head of the council. You choose. And you choose quickly, too.
I should have put you down myself. Personally.
You know, I never understood that. Why did you judge me? Why did you judge me?
You killed innocent people.
The means to an end.
You started a massacre.
I caused the revolution.
You betrayed the law.
Law! I betrayed this! Your council's experiment, which failed in you! I was your brother, your blood, your friend. Who betrayed who? When are you gonna stop being a goddamn slave and grow up? That's your birthright, that's your family. I'm your family. I'm the only family you ever had. Now choose!
The best thing you can do is kill me.
Why?
Because it's your only chance, brother.
Alright, so we shouldn't be causing our brothers to go off, especially if you know your brother got a weakness, say he got a weakness towards women and alcohol or something like that. So you shouldn't be trying to go to the club where the women is dressed loosely. And they are there for the taking. And the whole bar is there full of alcohol. You're going to take your brother there and put a stumbling block in front of your brother and cause him to go off. That's wicked as hell. And that's not loving your brother. You know what I mean? So we are not to put stumbling blocks in front of our brothers and cause them to fall. Let me read that one more time. Romans 14 and verse 13. Let us not therefore judge one another anymore, but judge this rather, that no man put a stumbling block or an occasion to fall in his brother's way. All right, so we got to be cognizant of, you know, the things that we deal with, the things that our brothers and sisters deal with, and steer clear of that, you know. And if we see our brothers going off, like it says in Leviticus 19, 17 and 18, we got to correct each other. We got to show that love, cry aloud, lift up our voice, and show our people where we going off, okay? That's what we got to do as watchmen, you know? We got to give the warning we got to give them warning of the Most High, okay? Not to go off and to keep these commandments, all right? So let me get another precept which goes into the laws. The laws were only given to Israel, okay? The law was only given to Israel, all right? I'm going to read that. I'm going somewhere with this, so bear with me. Psalms 147, verse 19 and 20. It says, He showeth his word unto Jacob, his statutes and his judgments unto Israel. Okay, so the law, commandments, statutes were given unto Israel. Verse 20, he hath not dealt so with any nation. And as for his judgments, they have not known them. Praise ye the Lord. Okay, so the Most High is only dealing with the children of Israel, the 12 tribes of Israel, okay? He ain't dealing with the other nations. He's not dealing with the Amalekites or Edomites or any other nation, all right? Regardless of what they tell you out here in the streets and in these wicked churches, that the Most High loves everybody. That's all.
Does God love all people? The answer is yes. There is not a person whom God does not love. What's wonderful about God's love is that it's unconditional. God doesn't love us because we're good, or we try hard, or we promise to do better in the future, or we're better than other people. No, God loves us unconditionally. He loves us, as it were, with no strings attached. When we look at the love of God, John in his epistle gives us a wonderful definition. He states in this epistle in the fourth chapter, he says, this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. So who does God love? He loves sinful people. He loves people like you and me who get it wrong all the time. People like you and me who offend him all the time. We are the object of his love, not because, simply because we're sinners. We are loved by God because God is love. And his love for us has been demonstrated in the death of his son upon the cross. God didn't talk about love. God showed us love, demonstrated love by saying, I will send my son who will lay down his life and pay in full the penalty of all of your sins. That's what love is. That's what John says. This is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be an atoning sacrifice for our sins. There's no one for whom Jesus did not die. There's no one whom God does not love.
Okay, but that's another subject we can get into at a later date, all right? So let me get another couple precepts. I'm going to go to it. Selaki, let me read this one more time, okay? It says, he showeth his word unto Jacob, his statutes and his judgments unto Israel. He hath not dealt so with any other nation. And as for his judgments, they have not known them. Praise ye the Lord. Okay. All praise the Most High. But Israel, you know, our people, this is repeated over and over and over in the scriptures because our people are hard-headed. Okay. We go off. We go off. We want to do what feels good. You know what, we want to do what we like, and that's where we go off instead of following the Most High. And the scriptures talk about how wicked we are and how we go off and how we commit sin. All right, so I got another precept here in Isaiah 30. All right, Isaiah 30 and verse 9, it says that this is a rebellious people, lying children, that will not hear the word, that will not hear the law of the Lord. All right, our people, we want to do what we want to do. We got that feel good spirit. I want to feel good, you know. I know what's right for me. And that's all. That's all the way off, all right? Let me read that again. Isaiah 30 and 9, that this is a rebellious people, lying children, that will not hear the law of the Lord. Okay, because we're rebellious. Verse 10, which say to the seers, see not, and to the prophets, prophesy not unto us right things. So they don't want to hear what's right. They don't want to hear the law. They don't want to hear, brother, you being a whoremonger. You out here making these sisters whores. You supposed to wipe these sisters up. Brother don't want to hear that. Brother want to go do his thing. He want to pump and dump. He want to deal with as many sisters as possible, but not take them to be his wives.
Sex has the following effects. It feels like your partner's in crime. The chemistry is very high because it's like you're stealing it. But after you've done it, it's always accompanied with guilt and awkward feeling. Huh? That awkward feeling is one reason men take off. It's a very bad feeling. Very bad. Because it was motivated by lust. You had to compromise principles to do it. You know both of you are doing something you're not supposed to be doing. But you justify it in your head. You justify it like, you know, there's no much difference. We are... One problem is the guilt, the embarrassment, the awkwardness that comes after it. That's one reason the man leaves. You don't want to face that again.
And that's wicked as hell. Likewise, the sisters want to deal with different brothers from different camps all over. You know, sisters in the truth and sisters not in the truth. That's off. We ain't supposed to live like that. All right. I'm going to read verse 10 again. It says, which say to the seer, see not. And to the prophets, prophesy not unto us right things. Speak unto us smooth things. Prophesy deceit. They want to hear the smooth things. They want to hear the Christian church. They want to hear your pastor say the Most High loves everybody. They want to listen to the pastor that says being a homosexual is okay. They want to listen to that. They want to listen to, sister, you can wear whatever you want. It don't matter. You know, it ain't the outside. It's in your heart. It's in your heart. That's wicked as hell, man. And that's what our people have a long history of going against what the scriptures say. All right? Got a long history of being a rebellious people that don't want to hear the truth of the Most High. And that's our problem. And that's why we're in the situation that we're in now. Trying to come back to the Most High in righteousness. And, you know, get the kingdom. If it be the Lord's will. Okay. I'm going to back that up with another precept. Okay. I'm going to jump over here, back over here to Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter 2, and I'm going to start at verse 2. It says, and the Spirit entered into me when he spake unto me and set me upon my feet, and I heard him that spake unto me. Verse 3, and he said unto me, son of man, I send thee to the children of Israel to a rebellious nation that have rebelled against me. They and their fathers transgressed me even unto this very day. So Israel was wicked back then, and they still wicked as hell to this day. And we gotta change our ways and repent and come back to the Most High. Or else we're going to be destroyed here in this wicked land of America. Okay, with our enemies. All right. So we're going to keep on pushing on ahead. I got another precept here that further proves this point. Israel, we gotta come back to the Most High and shake this wickedness. And we got to want that. More than anything else, more than your new car, more than your fly ramps, more than your fly woman and all that madness. We got to want to do the will of the Most High, okay? So Jeremiah, I'll jump to Jeremiah chapter 4 and verse 22. It says, for my people is foolish. They have not known me. They are sottish children. They are stupid children. And they have none understanding. They are wise to do evil, but to do good, they have no knowledge. Our people know all the scams, you know. We know how to go make all type of wicked money being sorcerers, selling drugs to our people. We know all the wicked ways to a T. But to do good, which is to keep the commandments, you don't know. Alright? We know wickedness. We thrive on wickedness. Alright? Because we lack understanding. A lot of our people lack understanding. Hold on, let me get a precinct. On power.
Am I my brother's keeper? Am I my brother's keeper? Yes, I am!
A family out to run a city are up against cops who know its streets.
This ain't business. This is personal.
This is big business. This is the American way.
Let me grab something really quick. You know, one of the classics, you know, Hosea 4:6. My people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee, that thou should be no priest to me, seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy Most High. I will also forget thy children. Our people are destroyed for lack of knowledge, man. All the knowledge that we know is wickedness, all right? But the true knowledge of the scriptures, which is the law, statutes, and commandment, we don't know, we don't follow. And I'm gonna get a quick precept to prove what this knowledge is, okay? That we lack. All right, Malachi chapter 2, verse 7, another classic. For the priest's lips should keep knowledge, okay? And they should seek the law at his mouth. So that knowledge is the law that we're not seeking. We're seeking everything else, every other kind of wickedness, but the law of his mouth, at his mouth. All right? It says, for he is the messenger of the Lord of hosts. All right, let me read that again. Malachi 2:7. For the priest's lips should keep knowledge, and they should seek the law at his mouth. For he is the messenger of the Lord of hosts. All right, that's the knowledge that we need to be seeking. The law, statutes, and commandments, okay? Let me get another quick precept here. All right. Psalms 111:10. It says, for the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all they that do his commandments. So when you begin to keep the law, statutes, and commandment, you get a deeper understanding, okay? You begin to fear the Lord. You begin to understand what it is to have fear of the Most High and to keep his commandments. All right, I'm going to read that one more time. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all they that do his commandments. So the more you keep the commandments, the more your understanding will grow. All right? All right, let me get a precept for that. Hope I ain't going too fast. I'm just trying to, you know, get these, tie these precepts up, and Lord's will bringing it out clearly. All right? I'm here at Job 28, verse 28. And unto man he said, behold, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom. And to depart from evil is understanding. To depart from sin, okay, and to keep the commandment is understanding. You're starting to get the understanding, okay, of the law, statutes, and commandments, okay? And what the Most High has laid out for us. All right? Let me get one more. All praise the Most High. Just want to touch on a couple things. Not going to be a long class. Just trying to get straight to the point, all right? So Proverbs 1:7, and it reads, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction." I'm going to read that again. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. What is that knowledge? We read it in Malachi 2:7. That knowledge is the law, okay? That knowledge is the law. But fools despise wisdom and instruction. Fools despise these law, statutes, and commandments, and proper instruction, all right? Correcting your brothers when they go on up. They despise that, okay? All right? So what we're seeing here is that we're supposed to keep the law, statutes, and commandments. The law, statute, and commandments are not done away with like they say in the Christian church. That's complete bull crap. That's off. And the scriptures also tell you, YAHAWASHI says that with his own mouth. Okay? Let's get it. Matthew 5:17-19. Let's get it real quick. Matthew 5:17. And it reads, it's, "Think not that I am come to destroy the law." Okay, so the laws have not been destroyed. They are not done away with. "Or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill." Okay, read that again. "Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill." So the Most High didn't come to destroy the prophets or anything that the prophets brought out, okay? He came to fulfill. And it describes what he came to fulfill. If you want to jump over to Luke 24:44, he'll tell you exactly what he came to fulfill. But that's another subject, so I'm going to keep reading. Verse 18. "For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled." Okay? And like I said, the earth is still here. The heavens are still here. So nothing has passed from the law. Okay, let's read a little bit more. Verse 19. "Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so." They teach men by the examples that they do. All right, the way that they live. "He shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven." All right. "But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven." And then just letting you guys know, ain't going to be no least man in the kingdom of heaven. You ain't going to make it. You're going to get put to death here in America or wherever you are. Okay? So we must continue to keep the commandments. All right? Nothing has been changed as far as that goes. All right. I got another precept for that. Let me grab Apocrypha real quick. We're going to go to another classic. Are you going to just jump over here real quick to, Baruch 4:1. All right. "The laws have not been done away with." Okay, not at all. Don't believe that. Believe this. Baruch 4:1. "This is the book of the commandments of God, and the law that endureth forever." Okay, so the law is going to endure forever. We always going to be keeping these commandments. All they that keep it shall come to life, but such as leave it shall die. Okay? Let me read that again. Baruch 4 and 1. This is the book of the commandments of the Most High, and the law that endureth forever. All they that keep it shall come to life. They're going to get the kingdom. Okay? But such as leave it shall die. They're going to get put to death. All right? I'm going to read verse 2. Turn thee, O Jacob, and take hold of it. Walk in the presence of the light thereof, that thou mayest be illuminated. Okay? So, it says, verse 2 again, turn thee, O Jacob, and take hold of it. Take hold of the law. Walk in the presence of the light. The light is the law. That thou mayest be illuminated. That thou may be illuminated. All right? Clean cut scripture. The laws, statutes, and commandment are not done away with. Okay? So don't believe Pastor Porkchop with his pork chop and bacon sandwich telling you that the laws, statutes, commandments are done away with. All right, tell them to prove that with the scriptures. That's one thing they can't do. They talk strictly from their own wicked heart and imagination. All right, and lead millions astray. All right, and we don't want to do that. All right, I think I got one more precept for that. Go to Isaiah 1 and I'm going to start at 19. If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. But if ye refuse and rebel, ye shall be devoured with the sword. All right? It's clean. It's a plan upon tables. You're going to get put to death. For the mouth of the Most High hath spoken it. Okay? So you must keep the law, statutes, and commandments. All right, people? All right? I got another one. I'm just going through these precepts. Hope it's not too fast. But I just want to make sure that the point is coming across, okay? I'm going to go to Proverbs 28. And we're going to start at verse 9. Okay, verse 9. He that turneth away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayers should be an abomination. All right? So you got a lot of people out here doing all kinds of wickedness. Okay? All kinds of wickedness. But they still go home and try to send their prayers to the Most High. Okay? The Most High ain't hearing that. The Most High ain't hearing your prayers. It says your even his prayers should be an abomination. Your prayers will be an abomination to the Most High. And Jeremiah 44 and 4 says the Most High hates abomination. So he hates your prayer if you're not keeping the commandments. That's wicked as hell to him. He don't want no parts of it. Okay? He's not hearing your prayer if you're not keeping these laws, statutes, and commandments. All right? Let's prove that. John, let's jump over to John real quick. John 9 and verse 31, and it reads, now we know that the Most High heareth not sinners. Okay, so the Most High don't hear sinners. The Most High don't hear sinners. Okay. But if any man be a worshiper of the Most High and doth his will, him he heareth. Okay, let me read that again. Let's make sure we got that. Now we know that the the Most High heareth not sinners. So if you're indulging in sin, you're not trying to keep these laws, statutes, and commandments, you're steadily going off, you want to live your way, the Most High ain't hearing the damn thing you're saying when you're trying to pray to Him. He ain't hearing none of that, okay? I'm going to read this scripture one more time because this is heavy, and a lot of people don't realize that they sending up these vain prayers and the Most High ain't hearing none of that. Okay. John chapter 9 verse 31. Now we know that the Most High heareth not sinners, but if any man be a worshiper of the Most High and doeth his will, okay, doeth his will, him he heareth, okay? What is the will of the Most High? What is the will of the Most High? You know, you ask somebody that, they'll give you 50 different answers. But it's written right here in the scriptures. And we're going to get it. Thus saith the Lord. We're not coming off stone. We reading what the scriptures say. All right? This is a classic. Psalms 40. And 8, Psalms chapter 40 and verse 8, and it reads, I delight to do thy will, O my Lord, O my God. Let me start again. I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart. Okay, so the law is the will of the Most High. Keeping the law, statutes, and commandment is the will of the Most High. Okay? All right? Let me get another precept. So, the will of the Most High ain't what you think it is. You must go to the scriptures and read what the scriptures say it is. The scriptures, the Bible is the mouth of the Most High. Let me get another precept really quick here. I'm gonna jump over to 2 Esdras, chapter 8 and verse 56, and it reads, for when they had taken liberty, they despised the Most High, thought scorn of His law, and forsook His way. So they thought scorn of His law. They thought the law was worthless when it says they thought scorn of His law and forsook His way. And what is the way of the Most High? We just read in Psalms 40 and 8. The law, the keeping of the law is the will of the Most High. So, let me read that one more time. For when they had taken liberty, they despised the Most High, thought scorn of His law, and forsook His way. So they turned from the law, statute, commandment. All right, they turned away from keeping the will of the Most High. All right, and that happens all too often, man. You know, people are out here creating their own righteousness. You know, and it's all feel good this, feel good that. And that's why we are at the bottom now, okay? That's why we've been separated from the Most High. Because we rebelled. Like the scriptures say, rebellion is as a sin of witchcraft. All right? A lot of our people are in witchcraft. All right? According to the scriptures. All right? So let me jump over. Let me read how YAHAWASHI even spoke on this and told the scribes and the Pharisees how often, how wicked they are, okay? Because of the things that they were doing. All right, let's get that real quick. Matthew 23, I believe. Matthew 23, and let's start at 25. It says, "Woe unto you scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye make clean the outside of the cup and of the platter, but within they are full of extortion and excess." All right. So you're putting on an appearance of righteousness and of keeping the commandments, but inside, you know, you got secret sins. You're going off. Okay. Verse 26, it says, "Thou blind Pharisee, cleanse first that which is within the cup and platter, that the outside of them may be clean." Verse 27, "Woe unto you scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye are like unto white sepulchres, which indeed appear beautiful outward, but are within full of dead man's bones and of uncleanness." Verse 28, "Even so, ye also outwardly appear righteous unto men, but within ye are full of hypocrisy and iniquity." All right. And that's too many of us, of Israelites today. All right. We want to give a false appearance of righteousness, but inside there's corruption and wickedness. All right. So we got to work on the inside, work on the spirit, get our spirit right, get our understanding right. Like Psalms 111 and 10. All right. Like the scriptures say. We have to keep the commandments to get our understanding better, all right? We have to fear the Lord, okay? All right, I'm getting close to the end. I only got a couple more precepts I want to bring out, all right? I'm going to jump back over to Proverbs. Proverbs 28. And now I'm going to start at verse 13. And it reads, "He that covereth his sin," all right, "he that covereth his sin shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy." Just like we were reading about, in Matthew 23, the scribes and Pharisees, they had an outward appearance of godliness and holiness, but the inside was filthy. So they had secret sins. And Proverbs 28 and 13 says, "He that covereth his sins," that means you have secret sins, "shall not prosper." You're not going to prosper. All right. "But whoso confesseth and forsake them." So he who confesseth his sins to the Most High and can and turns away from them shall have mercy. So the Most High will have mercy upon them. Thus saith the Lord, thus saith the scriptures. And verse 14 reads, "Happy is the man that feareth alway, but he that hardeneth his heart shall fall into mischief." All right. So him that you that have a hard head and continue to forsake the way and the commandments of the Most High, you're going to fall into wickedness. All right. You're going to be the brother that always gets caught up. You going in and out of jail. Okay. You always are not having enough to take care of what you need to take care of because you've fallen into wickedness and mischief. Okay, and that's That's the thing about our people. We don't want to, we want to do what we want to do until the shit hits the fan. Excuse my language. All right. And the Most High even speaks on that. And, you know, let me jump over to Proverbs real quick. Proverbs 1. Okay. And I'm going to start at 25. And it says, but ye have set at naught all my counsel and would none of my reproof. All right. So we didn't want to listen to anything that the Most High and YAHAWASHI laid out for us. Okay. I'm going to read that again. Proverbs 1 and 25. But ye have set at naught all of my counsel and would none of my reproof. Verse 26, I will also laugh at your calamity, and I will mock when your fear cometh. I mean, I don't know about you. I don't want the Most High laughing at me, okay? So, we gotta get our stuff together. Verse 27, when your fear cometh as desolation, and your destruction come as the whirlwind, when distress and anguish come upon you, then shall they call upon me, but I will not answer. They will seek me early, but they shall not find me. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be in that position, okay? So therefore, we have to humble ourselves and come back to the ways of the Most High. We got to come back to the light, okay? I got a couple more. I just want to touch on a couple repentance scriptures, okay? Because that's what it's going to take. We got to humble ourselves, repent from our wickedness, from our sins, come back to the Most High, and continue to keep the commandments, all right? So I'm going to go to the classic Acts 3 and 19. Acts 3 and 19. All right. Acts 3 and 19, and it reads, repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the time of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. All right. So let me read that one more time. Acts 3 and 19, repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the time of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. All right. So we got to repent and be converted. All right. Now, what converts us? What converts us? Let's get that precept. Another classic. Another milk scripture. All right, we're gonna go to Psalms 19. Psalms 19 and 7. It says, "The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul." So the law of the Lord is what converts us, or what changes us. Okay, I'm gonna start from the top. Psalms 19 and 7. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. Verse 8. The statute of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart, and the commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. Okay, so the law of the Lord is what converts us from wickedness to being righteous. So we have to keep the law to go from being wicked to righteous. That's what that's going into. Okay, how do we repent? All right. How do we repent? What is the way that was instructed for us to repent? All right, I'm gonna get the preset right now. 1 Kings chapter 8, and we're gonna start at verse 46, and we wind it down here. Only a couple more precepts. 1 Kings chapter 8, and verse 46. And it reads, if they sin against thee, for there is no man that sinneth not, and thou be angry with them, and deliver them to the enemy, so that they carry them away captive into the land of the enemy, far or near. Yet if they shall bethink themselves, okay, if they shall remember who they are in the land whither they were carried captives, and repent and make supplication, you know, we cry to the Lord and tell him our sins and beg for his forgiveness, that's supplication, unto thee in the land of them that carried them captive, saying, we have sinned and have done perversely, we have committed wickedness. Okay? And so return unto thee with all their heart and with all their soul in the land of their enemies, which led them away captive, and pray unto thee toward the land which thou givest their fathers, the city which thou hast chosen, and the house which I have built for thy name. Then hear thou their prayer and their supplication in heaven, thy dwelling place, and maintain their cause. Okay, so that's how we repent. We have to go to the Most High in prayer and tell him, Lord, we've been wicked. We've been sinful. We broke this commandment. We broke that commandment. That's the supplication. You got to cry out to the Lord and ask for forgiveness and turn from those sins, okay? So that's how we repent. And when we do that, the Most High say he will forgive us, okay? So we got to humble ourselves, man. We got to come back to the law, statutes, and commandment, okay? Brothers and sisters, we got to humble ourselves and know that our way is not the right way, all right? We want the Most High's way, which is the keeping of the law, statutes, and commandments. All right, and I got one more scripture that I'm going to bring out. Let me jump over to Chronicles, 2 Chronicles, chapter 7, and verse 14. I mean, there are plenty more scriptures that we can go to, but I'm just going to keep it simple and plain upon tables, all right? So 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face, the face of the Most High is the Bible, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Now mine eyes shall be upon and my ears attend unto the prayer that is made in this place. All right. So we got to humble ourselves, like the scriptures say. We got to come back to the Most High. All right. Or be destroyed in our wickedness. All right. So I'm going to read this one more time and then we're going to get out of here. In 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land. Verse 15, now mine eyes shall be open and my ears attend unto the prayer that is made in this place. All right, all praise to the Most High. All right, so with that, I'm gonna wrap it up, and see you again next week. All right, Shalom.